Good evening to everyone. Welcome to the session. I'm Subha Maheshwari, a program manager at AgriExplorer. AgriExplorer is an initiative for students where different activities are performed for students of agriculture, biotechnology, and related fields. AgriExplorer provides an internship opportunity to all these students. So today's session is also a part of this internship. Our today's speaker is Dibita Mandal from GM Khalsa College, Mumbai University, and she will be talking about the role of mushroom in bioremediation. Without taking much time, I welcome Dibita to have your presentation. If you have any questions, please drop them in the chat box below. Dibita, you can start now. Thank you.
Thank you, Subha, for the introduction. Good evening, everyone. I'm Dibita Mandal, student of Guru Nanak Khalsa College, Mumbai University, Bachelor's in Biotechnology. It's a privilege for me to present in front of everyone, and I'm grateful to the AgriExplorer team for giving me this opportunity. I hope to give my best at this presentation and try to get my point across. On that note, let's begin the presentation. Today, I'll be talking about the role of mushroom in bioremediation. Before starting on the role, let me give a brief idea about what is biotechnology. Biotechnology is a diverse field of biology that utilizes living systems and organisms to develop or make products. Biotechnology, that is the use of biology to solve problems and make useful products. Since it's concerning providing solutions or making things better, the root of biotechnology is the genetic alteration. Apart from that, it also includes making changes. Moving ahead, biotechnology consists of five branches on the basis of its application. They are animal biotechnology, medical biotechnology, industrial biotechnology, environmental biotechnology, and plant biotechnology. Animal biotechnology, it deals with the use of molecular biology techniques and engineering for the modification of genetic characteristics of animals in order to create transgenic animals. It's basically the genetic alteration of animals to produce enhanced breeds of animals that have better living standards with respect to the lifespan, longevity, and immunity towards diseases. Medical biotechnology, it deals with the diagnostics and development of pharmaceutical using living cells. The most appropriate example regarding medical biotechnology would be the current COVID situation. As we all know, vaccine development is the major part of medical biotechnology. Along with that, devising new strategies for treatment or diagnostics and more related things. Industrial biotechnology. It's involved in the commercial production of products and fermentation. That is production of products in large scale like antibiotics, probiotics, especially those involved. Treatment and pollution prevention. Bioremediation, which is the main topic for today, is a part of environmental biotechnology. Now, today we are going to learn about bioremediation using mushroom. Before starting with that, let's try to understand what is bioremediation. Bioremediation is the use of organisms to degrade the toxic pollutants into less to is increasing day by day, and it's very important to strategize new ways to decrease the level of pollution, but again, looking at the economic aspect of it. The term bioremediation can be broken down into two parts, bio, which means living organism, and remediation, which is to improve the condition, to be more specific, reverse the environmental damage. That's the whole primary focus of today. Now, types of two types, which is in situ bioremediation and ex situ bioremediation. In situ, as the word says, in place or remediation occurring at the contamination site. Ex situ bioremediation, out of place or remediation occurring outside the contamination site. In this, the product which needs to be remediated is taken outside of the place and the experiments are carried out to make it more environmentally friendly, like the waste product. Just a quick run through it. In situ bioremediation involves four processes. The first one is biosparging, which is increasing the biological activity of soil by increasing the oxygen supply by sparging air or oxygen into it. That is to facilitate the microorganism to act on its optimal level. Biostimulation, addition of nutrients to contaminated soil below the surface to stimulate the indigenous microbial population to degrade the organic matter. Now, most of the time we see that the contamination happening in soil is due to the organic contaminants present to it. The main idea is to degrade the organic contaminant into inorganic ones in order to reduce its toxicity level. Indigenous microbial organisms are the ones which are solely present in the site or at the location of contamination. And since they are present in the place of contamination, they are also subjected to develop mutation. Bioventing, which is increased oxygen supply with vapor extraction to remove any volatile removed out from the contaminated soil. So again, bioventing plays a very important role here. By increasing the oxygen supply, it's extracting the organic volatile organic compounds, and this in return facilitate the degradation. Bioaugmentation, which is addition of cultured microorganism, especially archaea or bacteria, to the soil to accelerate the degradation process. Ex situ bioremediation. Composting. Like, these are the parts of ex situ bioremediation. Composting. Combining the extracted contaminated soil with organic compounds or agricultural waste for the microbial population to carry the treatment process. Biopiling. Piling the soil in heaps within a lined area to prevent leaching. This is basically separating the soil, like the contaminated soil, from the area of contamination and adding treatment to it. Bioreactors, soil extracted from the contamination site, treated in a bioreactor with adjusted environment, like temperature, pH, pressure, etc. So, beginning with bioremediation or mycoremediation using mushroom. Bioremediation using mushroom is known as microremediation, in which fungi and mushroom is used for the removal or degradation of waste. Mushroom, as we all know, is a fungus. Hence, the use of mushroom in bioremediation is also known as microremediation, which is used for the removal or degradation of waste. Fungi produce enzyme that has ability to degrade a wide variety of environmentally persistent pollutants and transform industrial and agro-industrial waste into products. Persistent pollutants are the ones which stay in environment for too long and transform industrial and agro-industrial waste, basically the waste which are going to be dumped or discarded, so turning them into a considerably less toxic or more environmentally compatible products is basically what the enzymes produced by the fungus do. These enzymes include lignin peroxide, manganese peroxide, and lactase. Lignin peroxide is an enzyme that degrades lignin. Lignin is a polymer present in the vascular plant. Manganese peroxide has the same function, and manganese peroxide is produced by the white rot fungi. Again, it's a primary species used for the microremediation process. Lactase. It's the enzyme which renders color to the mushroom, and it also oxidizes phenol. Along with having enzyme degradation properties, mushroom also possesses a property of bioaccumulation of heavy metals, thus speeding the bioremediation process. Bioaccumulation is basically taking up the heavy metals present in the soil or the contaminated soil and accumulating it within its tissue. This speeds up the bioremediation process, which is turning the soil into a reliable soil, into a more healthy soil. Some of the characteristics of mushroom that makes it more likable choice for bioremediation is that they do not have strict condition of growth and can be easily grown most of the types of environment with little monitoring. Here, it's trying to say that mushrooms don't need strict incubation period or growth environment. They can easily grow provided they have the right amount of substrate and the temperature and the environmental condition. Again, if you're going to use mushroom for the bioremediation process, growing them is not going to be that difficult as for the same reason. It does not require strict in monitoring for the same process. And this leads to its cost effectiveness. This also makes mushroom production more economical and cost effective, just like I mentioned before. Mushroom tends to uptake the toxic components present in the soil if they are grown on a contaminated substrate. This property is known as bioabsorption, which leads to bioaccumulation. Heavy metal bioaccumulation is seen in the mushroom if they are cultivated or grown on soil contaminated with heavy metal, since they have the bioabsorption property. They take up the heavy metal absorb from the soil, proving its bioabsorption quality. So before understanding how the microremediation using mushroom takes place, it's very important to understand the anatomy of mushroom. So I'll go clockwise, starting from the scales. So the head portion of mushroom consists of scales, cap, the zonation, the areolae, which is basically for the oxygen transport, the gills, spores, which is responsible for the growth, for the reproduction and growth of the mushroom, reticulum, scales, the mycelia thread, through which all the processes happen, the basal bulb, vulva, stipe, stalk, the ring skirt, teeth present on the hind of the head, pores, tubes, rods, and striations. That was figure one. Moving to figure two, the mushroom is divided into two parts, the fruiting body, which consists of the spores, and the mycelium. The mycelium are root-like structure, but unlike roots, they are very fine and they grow into hyphae. Next is the life cycle of mushroom, how it basically goes through the reproduction process. The spores first are burst out of the mushroom, they fall on the land, and then they enlarge. Hyphae grow out of it, they germinate if moisture and food is present. So these are the minimum environmental conditions required for the mushroom to grow. Mating between hyphae from different spores, then they grow, hyphae feed and grow in soil. This gives rise to young mushroom forms, which leads to the fruit body. Next, how is microremediation using mushroom done? In microremediation of contaminated soil, three processes take place: biodegradation, bioabsorption, bioconversion. So in any sort of micro-remediant process, these three are the main processes taking place, that is biodegradation, bioabsorption, and bioconversion. Biodegradation, the term is described as a degradation or breakdown and recycling of complex molecule into mineral constituents. It is the process which leads to the conversion of organic compound to simpler or inorganic ones like carbon dioxide, water, nitrate, and other inorganic compounds by living organism. This process is known as mineralization. So mineralization, to sum it up, means breakdown of the complex organic compounds into the simpler inorganic ones. Since organic compounds contribute to the contamination level of the soil, it's very important to convert them into the inorganic ones. And this is what happens in the biodegradation process. This degradation is brought about by the enzymes produced by the mushrooms. Mushrooms have the ability to produce extracellular peroxidases, cellulases, pectinases, xylanases, and oxidases. Most of the enzymes, we know the function of it. So cellulases are basically those which is a part of the decomposition process, the cellulose decomposition. Pectinase degrade the pectin found in the cell wall of plant. Xylanase, it converts xylan to xylose, then to hemicellulose. Moving on. When tested in vitro, it was seen that they have the ability to oxidize recalcitrant product. Recalcitrant are the resilient one, or in simple words, are the ones which cannot be degraded easily and stay in environment for a long period of time. In vitro testing means testing in laboratory conditions. So when they were tested, it was found that they have the ability to oxidize these stubborn pollutants. These enzymes have also found to degrade non-polymeric recalcitrant pollutants such as nitrotolenes, organic and synthetic dyes, and pentachlorophenol under in vitro condition. Mushrooms have the ability to degrade polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbon, which is PAH. It has been reported that mushroom species are able to degrade polymers such as plastic. This is one of the biggest achievements with respect to micro-remediation. As we all know, plastic pollution is a matter of concern in the current time. So these are some of the examples of mushroom which play an important role in the degradation process. So there is Pleurotus osteus. The waste which they act on or grow on is the oxo biodegradable plastic. Mushroom degrade the plastic and grow on it. That's the property of this mushroom species. Pleurotus pulmonaris, radioactive cellulose based waste. So they work on the radioactive cellulose based waste containing mushroom mycelium, which was solidified with Portland cement. And then this solidified waste act as the first barrier against the release of a radio contaminant. So this solidified waste also acts as a substrate for the growth of this mushroom species. Pleurotus pulmonaris, which is involved in the process of crude oil degradation. Again, crude oil is degraded. Chlorius versicolor, it's the waste which it targets is the PAH. Mushroom possess the ability to degrade poly-R-478, which decides its suitability to degrade PAH. Lignin-modifying enzyme, lactase, which I've already mentioned before, manganese-dependent peroxide, and lignin peroxide was found to be produced for degradation. So these are the enzymes which act on PAH to degrade it. And this species, Chlorius versicolor, produce these enzymes. The next major part or the important process in microremediation is the bioabsorption. Bioabsorption is the removal of heavy metal or contaminants by mushroom from an aqueous solution, generally soil with high moisture content. So in order for anything to absorb nutrients out of a soil, it's very important for it to have a little moisture content. Otherwise, it's not possible for the mushroom or any living organism to grow on it. Bioabsorption is a process based on the absorption of metallic ions or xenobiotic pollutants from effluent by live organism. Here, which this is a mushroom, the live organism will be considered as mushroom, or dried biomass, which exhibit tolerance towards heavy metal contamination and adverse condition. Biomass is basically the residue obtained after burning the organic plant or animal waste. So this is a pollutant which needs to be converted. Bioabsorption is involved in this process. Xenobiotic pollutants are the chemical substance which are present in an organism, but it's not naturally produced. And most of the time, xenobiotic pollutants enter the organisms. The absorption of pollutants by mushroom involves a combination of two processes. First one is bioaccumulation, that is active metabolism dependent process, which include both transport into the cell and partitioning into intracellular components. And the second one is bioabsorption, that is the binding of pollutants to the biomass without requiring metabolic energy. So these two processes form the important part of absorption. As we see, bioaccumulation requires metabolism dependent processes. Bioaccumulation requires the metabolic dependent processes, but bioabsorption does not require that. The metal content in fruiting body is considerably affected by the many factors such as mycelium age, substrate composition, and the lifespan of fructification. Compared to that of plants and vegetables, the fruiting bodies of mushroom can bioaccumulate large concentration of heavy metals. Mushroom use mycelium, which is hyphae, to take heavy metals from the substrate. Those thin root-like structures are basically the ones which take up the heavy metals from the substrate. The metal content in fruiting body is considerably affected by many factors like the mycelium age and lifespan of fructification. We can also conclude from this that since the metal content is interfering with the fruiting bodies, the new mushroom which are going to be formed from these spores will also be having some amount of the heavy metals. To be more precise, wild grown Agaricus biosporus usually uptake more metals than cultivated Agaricus species. Excessive metallic content can be found in mushrooms growing near or at ore mining contaminated sites. Here, again, excessive metallic content can be found because the mushroom grows near to the site of contamination having ore mining. And over there, obviously, the metallic content is going to be more. The toxicity concentration decreases from the head to the mycelium with the maximum metal concentration in the sporophores, but not the spores. Intermediate metal content in the cap and the lowest metal content in the stipe. So the toxicity level decreases from head to toe. So it decreases from head to toe. So the maximum concentration is in the sporophores. Again, new mushrooms from the sporophores will have the contamination in it. Intermediate metal content in the cap, the lowest metal content in the stipe. So basically the mature part of the mushroom is going to have more toxicity. It is reported that the bioabsorption capacity of dead biomass may be greater or similar or less than that, similar to or less than that of living cells. In case of bioabsorption, dead biomass of mushroom offers certain advantage over living cells. Dead mushroom biomass can be obtained from industries as a waste fermentation process. Further, this is not sensitive to concentration or toxicants and their toxicity effect and adverse operating conditions, which is the pH, temperature, nutrient supply, initial metal ion concentration, and the concentration of cell, etc. Unlike living mushroom biomass. So here what it's trying to say is that the dead mushroom of biomass is having advantage over living cell because it can be easily obtained from industries as the waste of the fermentation process. So it will not include the time and the cost which goes into growing the mushroom or planting the mushroom at the site of contamination. And since this biomass is dead, I mean, it's made up of the burned dead part, dead organic waste of animals and plants, it is not sensitive to the concentration of toxicants. So the amount of toxicants present in the soil does not affect the biomass. And it's not altered by the pH, temperature, nutrient supply, initial metal ion concentration, or the concentration of the cell. But this considerably affect the living mushroom biomass. Role of mushroom in biosorption. So these are the examples of the mushroom playing an important role in biosorption. Pleurotus tuber regium, it acts on the heavy metals and it bioabsorbs the pollutant heavy metal from the soil artificially contaminated with some heavy metals. Sometimes it happens that due to some industrial process, the byproducts can lead to the contamination of soil with heavy metals, but it's not for a long duration of time. So this type of mushroom help in acting on these types of land which are on the initial stage of contamination. Pleurotus ostreatus, it works on the cadmium. Mushroom process bioabsorption capacity and mechanism of biosorption was observed. So this mushroom, which acts on the cadmium, they have biosorption capacity and they turn the cadmium in a cadmium-infused waste into a healthier soil or the site where the contamination has taken place. Pleurotus sager caju, heavy metal zinc. So it acts on the heavy metal, which is zinc. Mushroom bioabsorbs the heavy metal, hence converting the soil into a healthier one. Flammulina velutides, it acts on copper. Mushroom compost used as biosorbent for removing copper ions from aqueous solution. Here, a compost is used because it's acting on an aqueous solution. And as we all know, compost requires a little moisture content in order for the organisms present in it to act. The last process is bioconversion. Bioconversion is the process in which sugar is utilized from cellulose and hemicellulose to form microfungi metabolites essential for the growth and survival of macrofungi. As we all know that environment is changing and any sort of species to grow or to survive in the environment needs to undergo either mutation or should be supported with essential metabolites, which can again take their living metabolism and growth ahead. So for the need of survival, the microfungi metabolites essential for the growth are produced from this conversion. Wild mushroom are a potential source of secondary metabolites and enzyme as they have not undergone adaptation or mutation in response to adverse condition. So wild mushrooms are a potent source of secondary metabolites and enzymes because they have not undergone any mutation due to the adverse condition of the environment. So they are easy to act upon and also can have the nascent properties which are important in the degradation process of the contaminated soil. Secondary metabolites help mushroom compete and adapt to harsh condition and they are also used for the production of antibiotics, antifungals, and vitamins. Just like how we saw in the first point, bioconversion leads to the production of metabolites. These are basically the secondary metabolites which support the growth of wild mushroom by making it resistant to the environmental changes or making it more susceptible to the potential diseases. Mushroom is the most important bioconversion product, and the factors which make mushroom the most important is one, it is cost effective, and second, it's easy to grow, and third, it does not require any strict conditions to grow. It can easily grow anywhere. Any lignocellulosic waste generated by industries can be used for cultivation of mushroom, which can be further used as a product. Since the conversion has taken place, this can be used as a product. Role of mushroom in bioconversion. The species of mushroom involved in this are Lentinula tigrinus, which acts on the wheat straw, and it catalyzes the production of lignocellulosic enzyme and bioconvert the wheat straw. Wheat straw, again, it's a byproduct, it's a waste product. With the help of this mushroom species, the lignocellulosic enzyme convert these wheat straw, which can be compatible with the soil and can be disposed of easily with potentially less threat to the environment. Lentinula aedodes, which acts on the eucalyptus waste, successfully convert this waste, and qualitative and quantitative changes were also measured. So first, the conversion takes place, and next, the soil, which was the product of this conversion, was subjected to qualitative and quantitative analysis, and the related changes were measured. Pleurotus ewus and Lentinus cunotus, they act on paddy straw, sorghum stalk, and banana pseudostem. Waste successfully bioconverted by mushroom with good biological efficiency. So these mushrooms are very efficient in the conversion of these waste into a more eco-friendly waste, and they also have good biological activity. Pleurotus florida, it acts on the handmade paper and cardboard industrial waste. Same, it degrades and converts the waste into a more eco-friendly waste. Moving forward to the application of these application of micro-remediation. Macrofungi use enzymes to biodegrade and transform the lignin present in the wood to access cellulose and hemicellulosic chain. The enzyme degrade lignocellulosic material into sugar monomers for the production of ethanol by a fermentation process using yeast, which is of industrial interest. Ethanol is a very important compound when it comes, considering the fermentation technology, as we all know. Sugar monomers, monomers are used in the production of ethanol. So the enzyme degrade lignocellulosic material into sugar monomers, which further helps in the production of ethanol by fermentation process using yeast. And this increases the industrial value of this process. Mushroom cultivation in industrial waste provide protein-rich mushroom fruiting bodies and also help to solve pollution problems, which is the disposal or the conversion of lignocellulosic waste. Application of mushroom as micro-remediation tool in the bioconversion of these industrial waste into protein-rich mushroom carpophores, fruiting bodies, which are the fruiting bodies of mushroom, on one hand provides mushroom, and on the other hand helps in solving the pollution problem, which their disposal may otherwise cause. Here, the main topic of interest is that the mushroom not only convert the waste into a non-toxic form or a potentially less toxic form, But these mushrooms, to some extent, can also be consumed. So this is one of the advantages of mycoremediation. Again, there are some drawbacks to it too, that we'll discuss in the further slides. So the advantages of mycoremediation: the cultivation of edible mushroom on agricultural and industrial waste may prove to be a beneficial step with increased value of the waste as it is converted to potentially useful substance. The waste that is generally discarded or turned into less biological activity consisting biomass. The cultivation of edible mushroom. Since this mushroom is edible, so the cultivated mushroom with relatively less toxicity, or since it's involved in the consumption process, it has to be non-toxic. So the cultivation of these edible mushroom agriculture and industrial waste may prove to be a beneficial step with increased value of waste. So the value of this waste increase because it is converted into potentially useful substance. The waste can again be used in composting process or other processes, or the waste which can actually be turned into feed, even that can possibly happen with the help of this. This waste, which is generally discarded or turned into less biological activity consisting biomass. Biomass, again, as we know, is a matter of concern when it comes to the disposal of it, since it is burned and it's dead and it's of no use. So the waste on which this edible mushroom act on are not turning into less biological activity consisting biomass. Instead, the edible mushroom can be used for the consumption process, and the waste which is converted can further be used for other processes also. It also reduces the genotoxicity and toxicity of mushroom species, making it more feasible for use. Genotoxicity is basically toxicity to the genetic composition of any animal or plant, and toxicity of mushroom species. So mycoremediation decreases the toxicity of mushroom species. As we all know, some mushroom species have a little toxicity, and some mushroom species are called to be very toxic, which are not fit for consumption. Mycoremediation through mushroom cultivation will alleviate two of the world's major problems, that is waste accumulation and production of proteinaceous food simultaneously, as it is rich source of single cell protein. Single cell protein, as we all know, is the main source for the production of food, and it also plays an important role in combating the hunger problems with malnutrition and hunger problems with respect to the lack of food available in places where it's not easily, places with drought conditions. This contributes to the need for further research towards the use of mushroom as bioremediation tool and its safety level pertaining consumption and product preparation. So more research is needed with respect to mycoremediation. Mushroom have effective mechanism of heavy metal uptake and can degrade different types of waste. Mycoremediation can be carried out by two types of bioremediation method, that is waste treatment, can be done in in-situ and ex-situ conditions. The two types of bioremediation which we had seen in the previous slide, consisting of in-situ and ex-situ condition, both come in handy when mycoremediation is considered. In-situ mycoremediation eliminates the need of transportation, as the remediation is happening in the site of contamination. It's an eco-friendly approach which is also cost-effective and can be efficiently carried out in a small area. So there's no need of large space in order to carry out mycoremediation. And it can also be successfully carried out within a small area. It can help increase the employment, as high-end skills are not needed for carrying out this task, and basic level knowledge is enough for less skilled person to carry out the process efficiently. Coming to the drawbacks of mycoremediation, mushroom grown on contaminated site take up the soil content through biosorption, thus generating non-consumable biomass, which gives rise to the new problem of disposing it. Mycoremediation is time-consuming as mushrooms need the time to remove toxic metals and pollutants from environment and need considerable amount of time to acclimatize to produce the desired effect. So the two factors here in consideration is the time and the acclimatization of the mushroom. It's time-consuming, and also to adapt to the environmental condition, mushrooms take a lot of time. The toxicity level in the mushroom is a matter of concern as toxicity levels in mushroom increases due to biosorption and biodegradation when they grow on polluted substance. As we know, biosorption is taking up the heavy metal, and this metal content gets accumulated in the tissue of the mushroom, thus leading to the increase in the toxicity level of the mushroom, which makes it unfit for consumption. Mushroom cultivated on industrial waste may pose serious threat of toxicity in environment as well as genotoxicity, can affect the genetic constituent of an organism. Genotoxicity of mushroom is influenced by genotoxicant present in the contaminated site or the polluted substrate used for the cultivation. So the sites having genotoxic components present, they give rise to mushroom which has potential genotoxicity properties. Thus, the necessity of toxicological assessment of mushroom for using it for bioremediation process increases. Genotoxicity, teratogenicity and carcinogenicity evaluation is also under consideration. Teratogenicity is basically the problems caused during the development, and carcinogenicity, as we all know, the cancer development. Evaluation is also under consideration. With that, I would like to conclude. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dibita, for this amazing presentation. I'm sure everyone found the session quite informative. If you have any questions, you can ask them now or put it in the chat box. I can relate to her. If there are no further questions, then I hereby declare the session ended. Thank you, everyone, for joining in. We will have more such informative sessions in the future. Please stay tuned and please do join the groups, WhatsApp and Telegram groups for the session updates. Thank you.